Hello? Please, help me.
We are currently experiencing technical problems.
Warning. Warning.
Good afternoon, everyone. This is Brother Lloyd. And to those who are keeping the Sabbath today, I say Shabbat Shalom. I hope you are all having a blessed, peaceful, and wonderful day. Now, this lesson is titled, In Whose Image? Because we're going to talk about in whose image we all believe that we're created in, or so we think. So I'm going to break that down in a few minutes and maybe open a few eyes to give you a little different perspective. So go right to Genesis with me, Genesis 1:26, which reads, And God said, Let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. So the Father said, Let us create man in our image and likeness. Now, there are two things that he said. He said, let's create him in our image and our likeness. So he didn't say we're going to create him in just one. He stated two things. So let's find out what the definition is according to the dictionary. Now, image. Basically, it says image, a physical likeness or representation of a person, animal, or thing. Photographed, painted, sculpted, or otherwise made visible. So it's telling us that an image is something that is made visible based on something else. So that's a likeness. That makes sense. It says also an optical counterpart or appearance of an object as it is reproduced by reflection from a mirror, refraction of lenses, or the passage of luminous rays through a small aperture, or the reception on a surface, a camera. That's basically what that definitions talk about. A photograph through the eyes of a camera, the reflection, the image of which is produces a picture, blah blah blah. So that. Now it also says a mental representation, idea, or conception. So if you have a concept, an idea in your mind, and you are visualizing that, that's kind of what it's saying. That is an image. You know, I have an idea, I kind of see what I want, you know, that kind of thing. That is also an image. Psychology says a mental representation of something previously perceived in the absence of the original stimulus. Now, that sounds a little spooky, but it's kind of saying, you know, you're kind of creating something based on something you perceive. You're creating an image of it. So I get that. We can all get that. You know, you don't know what something looks like. Well, I kind of think it would look something like this. That kind of thing. Number five, it says form, appearance, semblance. And then it says our counterpart, copy, or a symbol, emblem. These things are images. Now, if we look at the Old Testament, they were full of imagery and images. All these little statues and figurines and things that they used to represent false gods. These were images. And this is kind of what it's talking about. Images, these kind of things. But the Father says, let us create man in our image. And he also said in our likeness. Now, likeness in terms of what? Well, he was talking about in the way they are, in character, in that type of thing. Go with me to Ephesians 4:24. We're going to clear that up right quick. Okay, we're going to read Ephesians 4:23 and 24 to put it in more of a context. 23 reads, And be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and that ye put on the new man, which after God is created in righteousness and true holiness. So, from my reference that I got in Genesis for Genesis 1:26, it told us what likeness is. It says, in righteousness and holiness. So the Father said, let's create man in our image. Maybe not exactly, but in our image, and also in our likeness, in our righteousness, and in our holiness. It makes sense. And that's what he did. He created man in his likeness and image. Now, this is where, for some part, we all lose track of really paying attention to detail. And until we really study and start digging and searching, sometimes we don't find out some things. So now we have the likeness and the image thing kind of clear. At least you should, based on what I'm showing you and teaching you out of the Word. We have that understood. Okay, now go with me to Genesis 3:5. We're going back to the garden where that old tired dragon, the serpent, Satan, is talking to Eve. And remember, he said this in verse 5. He said, for God doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be open, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. Now, you know what? Satan told her the truth. He said that you will be like God in that respect. See, she came to know good and evil, and she passed that right on to her husband by eating the fruit. So in that respect, they were like the Father. They knew good and evil. But go back to Genesis 2:25 and notice something here. Genesis 2:25, it reads, and they were both naked, the man and his wife, and were not ashamed. Now, that may seem like a small thing, but this was before they ate of the fruit. They were naked, they were in the garden, and they knew that they weren't even aware that they were naked. It wasn't something that they needed to be aware of. Think about your little children, little girls and little boys. They will run around naked and they aren't even aware of that until we start teaching them that, hey, you need to put something on your little behind here. See, we start programming, we start teaching these areas and things where you need to be ashamed of or unashamed of, and we start teaching these things. But see, Adam and Eve, they weren't aware of their nakedness. They were like two little children. It didn't come across their mind as anything. That was just normal to them. So this was before. And then after they ate of the tree, it says they became as the Father, knowing good and evil. And then go with me to Genesis 3 and verse 7. And it reads like this. And the eyes of them both were open, and they knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves aprons. Now they know they're naked. Now they have that shame about them to understand that they are naked. Hey, I'm naked. I'm embarrassed. I'm ashamed. They had changed. So not only did they become aware of good and evil, they became aware of the consequences of good and evil. They understood things like shame and hurt and pain, etc., etc. They knew all these things. But still, you're going, okay, what does this have to do with in whose image? Oh, we're getting there. So keep all these little things together because they add up to a big picture. Now, we go from there to Genesis 4, 1 and 2. Genesis 4, 1 and 2. Let's read. In Genesis 4, 1, it reads like this. And Adam knew Eve, his wife, and she conceived and bare Cain, and said, I have gotten a man from the Lord. And she again bare his brother Abel, and Abel was a keeper of the sheep, but Cain was a tiller of the ground. Now, we know that these were the first two children of our first earthly parents, Adam and Eve, Cain and Abel. And we know because of their fall from grace, they became aware of good and evil. And the Father told Adam this in 3:15, if you remember. He said, "And I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed, and it shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel." Now, no sooner than they had Cain and Abel, and they became of age, what happened? Enmity. Well, let's see what enmity is for those of you who don't know. Simply put, enmity is hatred, ill will, animosity, antagonism. So, like I said, no sooner than those two boys became of age, Cain murdered his brother. See, the Father allowed that enmity to be put between his seed and her seed. That hatred, that evil, that antagonism, all that stuff. So, these were yet still consequences of them being disobedient. But you're still going, okay, what does this have to do with our image? Okay, go with me to Genesis 5:3, and it reads like this. "And Adam lived 130 years and begot a son of his own likeness after his image, and called his name Seth." So, after Cain killed Abel, when Adam was 130 years old, he knew his wife. He had relations with his wife, and born from that was Seth. But notice what the word says. It says, "and begot a son in his own likeness after his image." So have any of you put it together yet? Okay, for those of you who are slow at this, I'm gonna put it together right quick. Remember way back, the Father said, "Let us create man in our image," and our likeness. And who did he create? He created Adam. Then he created Eve from Adam's rib. They were created in the Father's likeness and the Father's image. And then after all that chaos and drama, Adam and Eve created children in their image. Now, you may not think about it, but here's the reality. Before they fell into sin, they were in the Father's likeness and his image. They were pure, they were perfect, they had that glory about them, whatever that meant. They were in the Father's image. They didn't know shame or guilt or any of that. Once they ate the fruit, they lost all that. They were aware of their nakedness. They were aware of good and evil. Their likeness to the Father was gone. So whatever happened changed them. Remember when Moses was on Mount Sinai? He could only see the glory of the Father going by, because a direct view of the Father would destroy him. So even Moses could only see a glimpse of the Father's glory as he passed by. So the point I'm making is Adam and Eve were made in the Father's image and the Father's likeness. Adam and Eve's children and every single one of us since are made in Adam and Eve's likeness and image. We know good and evil. We know when we're naked. We sin. We are all that. We are not the direct image and likeness of the Father, as we all have thought or think we are. We are the image of Adam and Eve. That part of the Father, when it comes to the likeness and image, they lost that for us. Understand, this is why we have to work so hard to become renewed and become all these things to be accepted into the kingdom when our time comes. Because as of now, we are not in his likeness and image. We are in the image of Adam and Eve, with all the sin, with all the filthiness, with all that. We have to cleanse this stuff away from us and recreate that image that's going to be acceptable to him. And this is why when he comes for the resurrection, he's going to change these filthy bodies back to his image, that glorious image. But we have to change our character in righteousness and holiness. So anyway, with all that being said, the next time somebody wants to debate with you about whether the Savior, Yahshua, is black or white, long hair, this, that, and the other, it's all a wash anyway, because none of us know. And with that being said, this is Brother Lloyd. I'm out.